Recently, there had been significant news regarding the room temperature superconductor from Professor Rangadia's lab. Some individuals claim it to be a fraud, while others view it as a scientific breakthrough. Consequently, I found the original video on YouTube. Let's watch it and see if we can assess its credibility and look for any signs of lies. Disclaimer: this video represents my personal opinion and perspective on the matter at hand. It's not intended to be taken as factual information or as a professional analysis. Viewers are encouraged to conduct their own research and come to their own conclusions. I don't take responsibility for any action taken based on the information presented in this video.
Superconductors are the material which does not have any resistance. This idea, superconductors, was discovered way back in 1911. But all these years, we were always stuck to these very, very, very low temperatures. But then, for the last 6-7 years, we start to see the very much like increasing in this transition temperature, getting close to the room temperature. But there's a caveat. This happened at very, very high pressures until now.
In the first paragraph, he is introduced to the background. And so far, everything seemed good. There's no signs of light.
If we had zero resistance conductors, we could have trains that could be levitated and transit people from one corner of the country to the other with almost no power. It would completely change the way electric cars work. Magnetic resonance imaging is quite expensive. That would tremendously change also. Even fusion could potentially be dramatically changed, our quest for fusion. We sort of imagine that this could be a real revolution in technology.
He introduced how these superconductors could benefit us in the future. There's no signs of a lie.
The new discovery is the first time we are demonstrating a material that superconducts at room temperature and near ambient pressure. Before, the pressure was 270 gigapascal. The new discovery, now we are at 1 gigapascal. From 270 to 1 gigapascal, we don't need diamond anode cell now. There are different other ways to mimic these pressures by using strain engineering or very, very various different techniques. So that's why we are very excited that this is now in a region that we can easily access in terms of pressure and in terms of temperature.
He continued to talk about the new discovery, and there are still no signs of lies.
There are both worldwide implications and certainly implications for our community. We envision the clear possibility of making Rochester a center for everything that is related to superconductivity. We are gradually stepping from fundamental research into the engineering. And with the engineering will come, obviously, the industrial applications. So I think this will bring us as close as possible to the realization of what we consider the holy grail of superconductivity, having superconductivity at room temperature at conditions that can be then transferred into any industrial production, industrial applications.
He was imagining how to industrialize, say, superconductor as an engineer. Who wouldn't do so upon hearing such a scientific breakthrough? It is indeed a natural reaction. There are still no signs of lies.
So these kind of huge claims need a careful, thorough examination. So because of that, it went through a rigorous review process. Multiple referees, multiple rounds, and we made all the data and everything that we discussed in the paper, our methods and everything very open, so everybody can take a look at it and go through it and really make sure that they come to the same conclusion.
This lab is named after him, which means he's the head of this project. He explicitly emphasized that the examination had been reviewed by multiple referees in multiple rounds, ensuring that all data and findings are presented in a transparent manner. These steps are essentially part of the standard scientific experiment process. He doesn't even need to provide excessive detail to the public, as it is not the most captivating aspect for people. Normally, you would emphasize the key findings and the conclusions. Therefore, if there is something wrong with the results of this experiment, it must be due to an error or issue in this process. Let's explore if there is any additional evidence that can support this claim.
I never seen a material transform color like this. So it's a blue color. So you put in the laminate itself, you squeeze it. This blue turns into a very bright pink color. And then you squeeze further and become bright red. I was joking with my students that we're going to call it red matter because of the movie Star Trek. Oh, it's red matter.
You can see how genuine he looked and how detailed he describes it was, making it look like the color-changing material is a real thing. But that doesn't mean it is a superconductor. People often lie by mixing in real details to make others believe their lies. So while the color change might be a fact, it doesn't prove that the material can actually be a superconductor.
One of the things I find really exciting about this work is that it involved not only faculty at the University of Rochester, but also graduate students and undergraduate students took part in this research.
I work with the testing of the materials, so I use the diamond anvil cells to test spectroscopy to see how the properties change with pressure.
Everyone in my group, not just one single student, every graduate student, every postdoc, every undergraduate student, everybody just put into this project. It's a success of a team. Credit to them. So this belongs to them.
He was talking about how many people involved in this whole thing. He was saying that because so many people saw it happen, it is supposed to be a proof that it wasn't fake. But seriously? That actually a sign that someone's lying. As a matter of fact, this shows that not everyone was in on the plan to fake the results. But it also suggests that everyone must have seen the same results, so it had to be just one person or a small group of people who faked it. According to what he said, they had two ways to do it. One way was to have someone manipulate the results. The other way was to mess with the measurement devices. I think it's more likely they went with the second option. No matter which way they have chosen, wrong idea must be involved.
Machine learning can be applied to almost anything. When you apply it to superconductors, it's about collecting the data that revolves around what predicts a superconductor. What I've been doing is trying to create a machine learning model that's going to take in a lot of data that has already been found about superconductors and use it as a platform to make more predictions about what can be superconductors and just help make everything a lot more efficient.
We need to be able to scale this up so we have large-scale materials that also exhibit superconducting properties. We have to think about how do you manufacture these materials? How do you make them commercially viable and usable so that we can achieve some of the promise that this discovery holds? That's what we're about at the Hagen School of Engineering and Applied Sciences and at the University of Rochester. It's really why we are a research institution, is to find these new discoveries, to build new machines, to develop new tools, to help humanity move forward.
There's a lot to be done. This is just a first step, you know, very beginning, the starting point for many, many discoveries to come.
In conclusion, the findings of this experiment turn out to be fake, which means they cannot be replicated. Thank you for watching, and please share your thoughts in the comments below.